Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, after a day on which blizzards have swept most of Britain, This Is Your Life is waiting to meet a hero of the sea, a hero of seas like this. A man who has spent his life challenging and triumphing over such seas, and who is the only living holder of 2 Lifeboat Institute gold medals for bravery. He's on his way here now for a meeting to organize a film premiere in aid of lifeboat funds. We've disguised the entrance here to make it appear that this is where his committee meeting is. But as you can imagine, when he walks in here, we're going to ask him to postpone that meeting. Good evening, yeah. Ladies. Good evening. Thank you, Commander Hardy. Whoa! Yes, ladies and gentlemen, you have not met before. Richard Evans, BEM. Tonight, this is your life, not your committee meeting. Said we've beaten them tonight. Richard Evans, your whole life, well, you get your breath back, let me tell you, has been bound up with a tiny Welsh village, Moultrie in Anglesey, that most of us have barely heard of. You were born there 65 years ago and grew up with the sea and the ships on your doorstep. Your father was a sea captain and you were brought up in that house, Bay View. And the lifeboat station was only a few hundred yards away. Then, as now, the warning maroon would shoot into the sky, and as a child, you would see your grandfather and your uncle answer that call. Now, this is a livelier committee meeting than you were expecting, but during your 16 years as coxswain of the Moultrie lifeboat, you and your crew have saved 307 lives at sea. Your old crew would love to be here with you tonight to share this evening, but of course they cannot, as you well know, especially on a night or weather like tonight, the call might come at any time. But in fact, we have a surprise for you, because if you watch that screen, up there at Moultrie, 300 miles away, a live outside broadcast is there so that your crew can greet you. Hello, boys, are you getting us from London?
Hello, hello.
Hello there.
Well, now, the new cox, Merle Francis, you're the new cox.
Hello, Eamon, hello, Dick. I best you wish we were rescuing you from there tonight.
And Evian Jones, you were one of the younger members of his crew. You're a carpenter in the village.
That's right, hello, Eamon, hello, Dick. It's a very proud moment for me as a new face aboard this boat. To have having this opportunity in sharing this momentous time with Dick here in another page in his own personal history. And I'd like to just congratulate him very much and wish him a happy evening.
Thank you, Evian. And Maynard Davis, electrician.
Hello, Eamon. Hello, Dick. After 32 years of serving you on the lifeboat, I hope you can keep us calm and collected there tonight as what you have always done while you were on the lifeboat. All the best, Dick.
Well, you should have heard what he said when I threw the book at him. But, I want to have a quick word with Merle Dick. Merle Francis in particular. To continue this story, I want to ask you to take your mind back to the night of December the 2nd, 1966.
When we rescued the crew of the Greek vessel.
And that was the night, in fact, he won his
gold medal.
His second gold medal, indeed. The name of the ship was the Nafsiporus. And there was another member of your crew besides him that night who was with you on that dramatic rescue, serving with you as an able seaman, although he is a former captain of the luxury liner, the Empress of Canada. Come in, Captain David Jevons.
Amazing.
No, stay where you are. That's all right, Dick. Beside us there. But now, first of all, Captain, I want you to tell me, what's the captain of a luxury liner doing as an AB seaman in a lifeboat?
Well, after many years of association with Moira, I think it only natural for professional seamen to volunteer to be a member of a lifeboat, especially with Dick as coxswain.
Very different from being on the bridge of a liner.
Somewhat closer to the water, yes, indeed. Yes, yes.
Captain, was there ever a moment during the rescue we've just talked about when you thought it wouldn't make it?
There were several times. In fact, I expressed his opinion to Dick himself.
What did he say?
Well, he was saw fit to disagree at the time. Stuck to his wheel and went in just the same, successfully, as you know. But what I think is even more remarkable is the fact that out of a crew of eight, I was the only non-Welsh-speaking member, and even at the most extreme moments of stress, at no time was any language other than English used. I think this is quite remarkable.
This was great thinking. How old was Dick at this stage?
At that stage of the game, Dick would have been... Dick, they know now about you. Dick would have been 63 then, but despite this fact, he stayed an open wheel, mark you, an open wheel, in winds of over 100 miles an hour and with temperatures in the low 30s. I think it quite remarkable.
How long did he stay at that wheel?
13 hours, plus. Dick, it has been my privilege to stay around you. Thank you.
Thank you, Captain Devon. Now, for that feat, Richard Evans was awarded the highest honour the Royal National Lifeboat Institute can give, the gold medal. And, Dick, you brought the crew of the Mephciferus safely to shore, but the captain and three others refused to abandon the ship. As you pulled away, did you think they had chances of survival?
At the time, no. I think I was begging them to come to leave the ship in Welsh. And I think they were answering me in Greek that they wouldn't.
Well, in fact, the winds changed and they were towed to safety. But the man who put out the Mayday signal that morning has never forgotten just what his crew owes to you. And he's flown from Greece tonight to be with you, the captain of the Mephciferus, Captain Angelos Katsoufis. Captain, that when we rang this man in Athens, he dropped everything to be here tonight.
Yes, I want to thank you once more for your assistance on this day. My crew, it's impossible, I mean, to be this night here, so I want to thank you on behalf of them once more.
Thank you very
thank
much.
You, thank you, Captain Katsoufis.
Thank you.
Richard, these are days on in your life, but you were in fact first putting to sea when you were a child of only eight.
Oh yes, that's how we got our Woodbine money.
Your childhood friend and former skipper, Captain Tom Hughes. tell us, how did you and Richard, you know, get money from at the age of eight?
Oh, sir, we were always on the lookout. Always on the lookout for the lifeboat to go out on a day when it was impossible for her to put back to the slip. And our fond hope was that she would go on the buoy, call for us boys to take the crew and any survivors that were there onto the sheltered beach. And then, for tuppence, we'd get five woodbines.
Shipwrecks were an accepted part of village life, but I believe that there was, you know, even some signs of good fortune at times.
Oh, in the early 20s, we had one of them, there's no doubt. We had one, a vessel came ashore. Fortunately, she came ashore quite close to the lifeboat station, and the crew were able to walk ashore. And believe me, that was the grand bonus for the village.
How was that?
It took us a little time to find out that the authorities, as usual, are rather slow moving. And we moved in one night to find ourselves a huge cargo of coal.
Coal?
Coal.
So you kept warm that winter?
Not only that winter, I do believe, sir, but for several winters following that.
Thank you, Captain Hughes. Thank you.